Welcome to Shrewsbury Community Church this morning. Let's begin this morning with the invocation and Lord's Prayer from John.
Dear Lord, we gather together this summer morning as a congregation. We lift our songs of praise to you, proclaiming your greatness for all present to hear. You are the one true God, the creator of all things. All that we do is only possible through you. It is because of this we seek you out, seeking to best serve you and your kingdom. Now let us all join the Lord's Prayer, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Again, good morning and welcome on this beautiful Sunday. I do have a few announcements. After church this morning, we will have church chat during our fellowship. Today is food pantry day. If you did not bring your donation this month, if you plan to make one, then you can leave it on the front porch of the post office up until Wednesday night. Next week is birthday Sunday, so we will be having our birthday brunch. And I have one more week of testimony available. If someone who has not volunteered would like to do testimony, it will be on Labor Day weekend. So I would love to have one more person volunteer and tell a little bit of their story. Just see me afterwards. Phil's funeral is at 11 a.m. Saturday, August 26th, right here in the church. It will be followed by a lunch downstairs. So I hope everyone is able to come to that. Also, there is a concert at 4 o'clock today on the Belchertown Common.
Yes, there is. This year, the Belchertown Community Band is doing an extra Sunday concert, and it was we said it was shine or shine, so we weren't going to do it inside,
yeah.
Only outside, but it looks like the weather is going to hold.
Yeah.
And so today at 4, we're doing a lot of the old favorites of the Belchertown Band, and we've asked some of our alumni that don't get to play the whole season anymore to come back for the day, so it should be a fun afternoon.
Oh, that'll be great.
4 o'clock today.
That sounds like great fun. So anyone who's available at 4 o'clock this afternoon, that sounds like it'll be great fun. Any other announcements this morning from anyone? Our speaker this morning for testimony will be Peggy, and she's fairly new to the church, and so a lot of you, I think, will be learning things that you didn't know, because we've been learning all kinds of things we didn't know all through the summer as people have given their testimony. It's been wonderful getting to know how God works, but also getting to know how some more details about people's lives. So let us now go to the Lord with our worship and our songs.
How great thou art, great thou art, and sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, and through the woods and forests the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain gradual and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to how great thou art, how great thou art, and sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, and sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. A joy shall fill my heart, and I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. And sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And sings my soul, my
Psalm 40, verses 1 through 4, 9 through 11. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who does not look to the proud, to those who turn aside to false gods. I proclaim your saving act in the great assembly. I do not seal my lips, Lord, as you know. I do not hide your righteousness in my heart. I speak of your faithfulness and your saving help. I do not conceal your love and your faithfulness from the great assembly. Do not withhold your mercy from me, Lord. May your love and faithfulness always protect me.
prosper.
When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph.
My God will never fail. My God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Turn it for good, you turn it for good.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good, you turn it for good.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. And you turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, for good, you turn it for good. Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure that he shall give his only Son to make our wretch his treasure. How great the pain of seeming loss. The Father turns his face away as moved by the chosen one. Bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice, how loud among the scoffers. It was
Lord Jesus, we are so indebted to you for your sacrifice on the cross. We know each one of us is a sinner. Each one of us deserves death everlasting. And yet you came along and you gave your life so that we might indeed have life everlasting. Life in your heavenly kingdom. Standing before you, bowing before you. You have promised to give us each crowns. So undeserving are we. And yet you love us so much that you have offered us the kingdom to be partners in your inheritance, to be brothers and sisters to you, to be children of God in the everlasting place. Oh, Holy Jesus, we are so grateful for what you have done for us, for sending the Holy Spirit to live within us, to teach us and guide us through this very difficult life that we live here on earth. Oh, Holy Lord, we feel so, so very blessed by you and by what you've done. Holy Father God, we are so grateful for your sacrifice to watch your Son die on the cross for us, to suffer that pain and that sorrow seeing him go through such pain and sorrow. And we are grateful, for without that, we would have no future. We would be miserable and lost for all time. We thank you. We praise you. We pray this in your holy name. Amen. Now Anne will come forward and do the prayers this morning. Anne.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just come before you this morning with thankful and grateful hearts for who you are and what you do, and just all that you create us to be. We thank you, Lord God, for your love, your commitment, and your mercy. We thank you that you are our rock, that you are our comfort in times of chaos, that you are our joy when things seem to be going awry. And Lord, we just thank you that you are our comforter, that you are our Jehovah Jireh. And Lord, I just thank you with all of my heart for this beautiful life that you have given us. And Lord, we just come before you knowing that we are not worthy of what you give us, but still you choose us. You choose to care for us. You choose to love us. And Lord, that is just beyond anything I can imagine. And Lord, you hear us when we come before you with prayers and thanksgiving. And Lord, we do have prayers and thanksgiving in our hearts. We pray for Lori, who took a fall the other day and now has to have surgery. We pray for your direction and your guidance for the surgeons, that it would go successful without any complications. We pray for Vicky as she's going through more testing next week, and we just pray that it would all come back okay, there would be no complications, and that she can just continue on the path of help that she's on. And we just thank you, Lord, that you are with her. Lord, we thank you that you brought Becky and the girls home safely to us. And we pray for that whole family as they go through this time of grief after losing Phil, a father, a grandfather, a great-grandfather. And we just pray for peace and comfort for that whole family, because losing someone you love leaves a hole in your heart and in your life. And Lord, we just pray that you would go in and fill those gaps, that you would just comfort Becky in a way that only you can, that you would just bring peace and joy to her heart, knowing that he's in heaven, knowing that he's with you and with her mom, and that they're celebrating together, and that she knows she'll be reunited with them one day. And Lord, we just thank you for your provision, and pray for your wisdom and guidance for our government and our leaders. There's just so many things going on in this world that is just difficult to watch. We watch people that are homeless. We watch people with mental illness not getting the treatment they need. We watch people that are just lost. They don't have an identity. They don't know what they're doing in life, and they don't know where to go or turn to. Lord, I pray that you make us that source, that resource for them, to lead them to you, that they would see that by giving their lives to you, you provide the answers, and you provide the healing, and you provide for their needs. And Lord, we just pray that you will help us to reach those who are desperately seeking answers. And Lord, we just thank you for all that you do. And we love you, Jesus, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Anne. Our speaker this morning, who will be giving her testimony, is our dear Peggy. And we are, at least I am, looking very much forward to that. Would you like to do it from there, or would you like to come up here, right there? Okay, well, you go right ahead.
Good morning. I was born in Chile, South America, with a twin, and my parents were missionaries in Chile for 23 years. And then when they were there 23 years, they were asked to come to Costa Rica. And they were in Costa Rica for 17 years, starting a farm there. My father was an agriculturalist, and he was also a pastor, and he also taught in a school in Chile, and my mother also taught in a school in Chile. And when we were 12 years old, we came to the States for 1 year. That was right after the war. And then there were four of us, and all four of us were born in Chile. One brother and I have dual citizenship, Chile and United States, and the other two don't, just because they didn't apply for it. And I did, and the other brother did. And in Costa Rica, Mom and Dad, the mission board purchased, gave them money to purchase a farm in Costa Rica, in northern Costa Rica, to teach the farmers new ways of doing things, new ways of planting coffee. And everything was very different from Chile. And my sister and I were very glad to be back in Latin America, because that's where we had grown up. We went to school in San Jose, which is about 3 hours by car. Nowadays, because of the roads, it's only about 2 hours. But it seems like the Lord's timing in so many things. When COVID came, I was in Costa Rica. I had just arrived March 3rd. I arrived in Costa Rica, and I think about March 8th, March 9th, COVID was announced across the world. And we had a team that came about 2 days after I came, and we were all so afraid for them, because here it was COVID and nobody knew what to do. Nobody knew if they would be able to go back to the States or if not. But they were able, they were told they would have to quarantine, which was a surprise. The big majority of that team were young people, so that was quite an ordeal for them, that they would have to quarantine. And then fast forward to May, and in May, on Saturday, this Peruvian friend told me, "You need to go back to the States. This COVID is not going to get any better." And then the next Sunday, my daughter called and said, "You need to leave immediately for the States." Well, of course, I wasn't expecting to leave, and I didn't have any packing done. And called to find out about airplanes. All the airplanes were grounded. Nobody could fly out. And so somehow a pastor friend of mine, he came and he somehow got me a ticket to get out of the country. Usually it costs about $800 going and coming, but this time it cost $1,000 just to leave the country. And I had permission to be in the country. I had a resident visa for only 2 years, and it would give out in June of the next year, of 2021. Well, if I left, then they would not honor that visa anymore. And so it was leave. And since I didn't have anything packed, I had to, in a hurry, get everything ready, pack the house, get rid of most everything. My friend Gisela is taking care of the house and took care of it at that time, and there was a big table, and I just put all the stuff that I couldn't do anything with, I put it on the table. I had to take all my important papers with me, and I was only taking 3 suitcases because, you know, all the suitcases cost money. And it was so, so interesting. Just before that, my friend Rebecca had invited me to her farm, her parents' farm, and we went there just the day before I was to fly out. I thought that my ticket said 11 days more. I had been wrong, and that was not so. And so she was reading the ticket and said, "Oh my, you're leaving tomorrow." She hadn't realized that I was leaving so soon, because originally I had asked her to do it on Friday, and she said, "I can't do it on Friday, I'll do it on Saturday." So then she kind of felt bad that she couldn't do it that day. And I had to figure out what I was going to do about the dogs. I had 3 dogs, Baby and Rex and Scooby. Rex would cost $1,000 to bring to the States. Baby would cost $1,000 to bring to the States. Scooby, because he was pit bull, couldn't even come to the States. And so my Gisela and her husband Miguel, they took care of the dogs, and Scooby had been trained to fight, and so he still had scars around his neck. And so I was always afraid to walk him. I didn't walk him. He was in a dog run. And when a little bit later, Miguel was talking to a neighbor, and her neighbor said, "This particular kind of collar, and you can walk this dog." And sure enough, he walks him now. He doesn't walk him very far, but he can walk him along the street. And this is a little village, and of course there's lots of houses all around. And so now everybody sees Miguel with Scooby, and it's quite a sight, because Scooby, as you can well imagine, hauls him around. And when I came, my daughter wanted me to come to her house in Massachusetts, but Massachusetts had its borders closed. Colorado still had its borders open. And so then I went to my twin's house. She had to get the basement ready, and she had a complete apartment down there. And then when I got there, I had to be there 2 weeks in quarantine. And that was very hard. when your sister just lives up at the top of the stairs. And then, fast forward 11 months, I was living with my sister Kitty in Denver, and I had gone to visit a neighbor, and when I came back, I saw my sister sobbing uncontrollably on the table. I just knew that something had happened to her son. And sure enough, her son had been killed at work. A chain broke and somehow some kind of equipment hit him. And he was then transferred to the Greeley Hospital. He was in bad shape, and just a little bit later on, he got a heart attack and died that same day. His son has mental health issues, and his son was in the emergency room by himself. Fortunately, there was a nurse there that was very, very nice to him and stayed there until we came, because from Greeley to Denver is about an hour, and by the time we got stuff together, an hour and a half to get to Greeley. And he was very shook up, because that was the first person that they told that his father had died. And none of us were near enough to come immediately. And so the nurse said, someone needs to stay with him. Don't leave him, don't abandon him. And so I said, I'll stay with him. And so I stayed with him, helping him, taking him to work and cooking. And I stayed with him 6 months. And then at 6 months, his girlfriend came to live with him. So then I went back to Denver. That was in October. And then in June of that year, then I came here to Massachusetts. Thank you.
So God's timing is always perfect, and God put Peggy in the places she needed to be over that whole span of time, providing for neighbors who were unable to provide for themselves by forcing you, unfortunately, to leave behind things that were maybe important to you, but not near as important as to those people who received them when you left, and then putting you there to help your nephew?
Yeah.
Your nephew.
Great nephew
during his time of need. Our God is perfect in his timing. It is now time for our offering. And I wonder if Dwayne would be willing to take up the offering this morning? Yeah. We're doing tryouts, because, you know, unfortunately, we don't have Phil with us.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and his righteousness. Given unto you, seek and
be open unto you. Alleluia, alleluia. Let us not buy bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Please rise for the doxology.
God, from whom all blessings flow, praise Him, all creatures here below, praise Him above the heavenly host, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Holy Father, we are grateful for the blessings that you continually bestow upon us, for all the joy you bring into our lives, and for the security you provide through your gifts to us. And Lord, as we give back a portion this morning, we pray that it will be used in your will and to your glory here in the church, in this community, and around the world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. They say that good things come in small packages. That's certainly true of today's scripture passage, Paul's letter to Philemon. This is the shortest of Paul's 13 epistles that are preserved in the New Testament. It is just 23 verses long, and it's in original Greek. It is only 335 words, which makes it the third shortest book in the Bible, just a bit shorter than 3 John and 2 John. But like a diamond ring, which comes in a package that fits neatly in the pocket, it is a precious gift and an important message for all of us. It shows, through Paul's words, the greatness of our God. So let's listen as Peggy reads the letter to us this morning.
Paul's letter to Philemon. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother. To Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker. Also to Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your love for all his holy people and your faith in Lord Jesus. I pray that your partnership with us in the faith may be effective in deepening your understanding of every good thing we share for the sake of Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement, because you, brother, have reshaped the hearts of the Lord's people. Therefore, although in Christ I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do, yet I prefer to appeal to you on the basis of love. It is as none other than Paul, an old man and now also a prisoner of Christ Jesus, that I appeal to you for my son, Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he has become useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, who is my very heart, back to you. I would have liked to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I am in chains for the gospel. but I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that any favor you do would not seem forced, but would be voluntary. Perhaps the reason he was separated from you for a little while was that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother. He is very dear to me, but even dearer to you, both as a fellow man and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me a partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will pay it back, not to mention that you owe me your very self. I do wish, brother, that I may have some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I ask. And one thing more, prepare a rest room for me, because I hope to be restored to you in answer to your prayers. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends you greeting, and so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit.
Thank you, Peggy. So our ordinary person today that we are going to talk about is Onesimus, a slave to Philemon who fled from his home in Colossae and who made his way to Rome. But let's start with a little background. Paul, as you know, was a Pharisee who was then named Saul. His Hebrew name is Saul, his Greek name is Paul. And at the time of Jesus' death and resurrection, he was a vicious opponent of the new Christian religion that grew out of Jesus' teachings. And he made it his mission to imprison or even lead to the death of Christians. But on his way to Damascus, to round Christians up, Paul had a conversion experience when Christ showed himself to Paul in a vision and temporarily struck him blind. And from that moment on, Paul dedicated his life and himself to spreading the new Christian religion throughout the Roman Empire. For nearly 20 years, he traveled extensively through Asia, Galatia, and Macedonia, eventually all the way to Rome, preaching and establishing new churches. Now, we'll be looking at Paul's travels in more detail as we get back to the book of Acts in September and continue along with that sermon series. But this map that Pam will put up shows you the vast area that Paul travels. This is a map of his second missionary journey. His first one was also in the area of Macedonia, but it was a bit shorter. The second one covered a lot more ground, and the third one went all the way to Rome. So you can see this substantial area that he covered in his missionaries between the years 40 and 60 AD. Now, it's believed that Paul wrote this letter to Philemon between 60 and 62 AD when he was under house arrest in Rome, awaiting trial before Caesar. He had actually been arrested in Caesarea in Israel, but had asked for a trial before Caesar and so was sent there, and he was awaiting that trial. Now, because it was house arrest and because Paul was a Roman citizen, he was allowed to have visitors and helpers to his house. And there were guards there, and he was in chains so he wouldn't escape. not chains that prevented him from doing things, but prevented his escape. And most scholars believe that Paul, and one of those people that ended up with him was this Onesimus. He mentioned in the letter that Timothy was there. We know who Timothy was. Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke. And Epaphras was a fellow prisoner. And then along comes Onesimus into the picture. Onesimus was an escaped slave, as I said, owned by Philemon, who was the head of a house church in Colossae. Now, most scholars believe that Paul never actually went to Colossae to found a church, that he was in Ephesus and that Philemon had come to Ephesus, and there Paul had converted him to Christianity and then sent him back to Colossae to start a house church there. And that's how the Colossae church, the church of the Colossians, was begun. And you can see on the map the proximity of Colossae and Ephesus. They're the ones that are in red under the word Asia there. Those two cities are fairly close together, so there would be a good amount of travel in between. The letter doesn't tell us why Onesimus fled from Philemon's house, but it implies that Onesimus took something of value with him, something that belonged to Philemon, possibly money. And somehow Onesimus made it all the way to Rome. We don't know how. And he somehow ended up visiting Paul at his house arrest. And Paul writes in verse 10, "I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains." So this is a declaration that not only did Onesimus come to Paul in Rome, but during this time with Paul, Onesimus became a believer in Jesus Christ. And in many of his letters, Paul calls the people he has brought to Christ his children. Here he calls Onesimus his son in Christ. And it's on the basis of Onesimus's conversion that Paul appeals to Philemon for the welfare of this slave. In Roman society, slavery was not the same as it was in this country during the many years of slavery up until the Civil War. Oftentimes, there were, of course, Roman slaves that were taken as prisoners in battle and such, and they became slaves for life. But oftentimes, the slaves in the Roman society were people who were unable to pay bills, to get their debt paid off, and so they gave themselves as servants to the people they owed money to, and they worked for them, receiving pay during that time until pay toward the debt, until the debt was paid off, and then they would gain their freedom. And we can assume, I think, that Onesimus was of that status. But Paul called on Philemon to consider Onesimus' new status as a Christian when Philemon was considering the man's future. Paul had to send him back. Escaped slaves had to be returned. But Paul is asking him to consider that Onesimus is now a Christian brother, not just a pagan slave. Making a play on Onesimus' name, which means useful in Greek, and it was a pretty common name to give to your slave because slaves were useful in the household. And so there were many Onesimuses. But making a play on that word, Paul wrote in verse 11, "Formerly he was useless to you, but now he has become useful both to you and to me." Paul then goes on to say in verses 12 and 13, I am sending him who is my very heart back to you. I would have liked to keep him with me, and I love this little stab of guilt that Paul puts in here. I would like to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I am in chains. But I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that any favor you do would not seem forced, but would be voluntary. Now, I don't think Paul really expected that Philemon, the head of the house church in Colossae, excuse me, was going to come to Rome, but he could certainly have sent someone to represent him to Paul's side to assist Paul in his home. And in essence, that's what happened when Onesimus escaped and got there. Onesimus became a helper to Paul for some short period of time. And Paul is pointing out that that wasn't such a bad thing. And he also seems to be suggesting that he would be pleased if Philemon forgave Onesimus and then sent him back to Paul again in Rome to again still be the helper to him. Paul continues with his appeal to Philemon in verses 15 to 17. He says, "Perhaps the reason he was separated from you for a little while was that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother," that is, a brother in Christ. "He is very dear to me, even dearer to you, both as a fellow man and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me a partner, welcome him as you would welcome me." What a wonderful letter of recommendation. Kind of letter that you'd want someone to write if you were applying for a job somewhere, that you were a brother and you were upstanding and you were significant, and that the person should welcome you. So this is a strong statement that Paul makes. He's pointing out that to Philemon that what we have been learning here in the past few weeks, that God works in amazing ways to make a change in people's lives. And we see this with Peggy. The airports were closed, and when she needs to get home, all of a sudden they open again. She's going to go to Massachusetts, but the borders are closed, so she ends up stuck in Denver. But in Denver, she's needed because her great nephew loses his dad, and there's no one to care for him, and he has mental health issues. So Peggy's stuck in Denver, but God gives her a purpose while she's there. And then finally, her nephew is taken care of, and she gets to come home and be part of our church with us. And that's the greatest, for us, that's the greatest glory. But God had this timing all worked out, even through this time of COVID when everybody's life was a total mess. God works in amazing ways to change our lives. So was it God who led Onesimus to Rome? Onesimus probably fled on his own, but then God took action and led Onesimus to Rome? If so, if God was involved in this, then what would God think if Philemon decided to punish Onesimus with imprisonment or even death? That would be putting a really quick stop to whatever God's plan was for this man, Onesimus. As Paul suggests, wouldn't it be better for Philemon to welcome Onesimus back into his home as a fellow Christian, better to respect and honor him as a brother in Christ? But of course, there was still this problem of whatever Onesimus took from Philemon. And Paul addresses that in verses 18 to 19a. He says, "If he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. I will pay it back." Then Paul reminds Philemon at the end of verse 19 that when it comes to debts, Philemon owes Paul a huge one. A huge one. Because Paul brought Philemon to belief in Jesus Christ, just as he did Onesimus. Paul changed, was the catalyst for changing Philemon's life forever. And not only earthly life, but eternal life forever. All of these people in this letter were ordinary people, just like you and me. But God used them in their circumstances to make a difference for Christ. And their story is still making a difference because this letter was passed down through generations of Christians and became part of the canon of the Bible. And we get to read it today and think about it and ponder it and consider its meanings to us. And here we see the power of God's forgiveness displayed through people who have committed themselves to his service. The letter teaches us, without being preachy, that as believers, it is our responsibility to forgive others as God has forgiven us. After all, none of us is without sin, and only through the forgiveness of Christ by his death on the cross are we worthy to be even in God's presence. If we are unwilling to forgive one another, then as the Bible teaches, how can we expect God to forgive us? Christian author and pastor Jeff Shirley wrote about this in an essay about the lessons found in the letter to Philemon. He wrote, "The reason that we must forgive and restore relationships with one another is that we are all like Onesimus. That is the lesson. We are all runaways. We've run from God. We all stand guilty of sin and must face the consequences before the Lord. And just like Onesimus found refuge in his advocate, the Apostle Paul, so we have an advocate before the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul took Onesimus' debt just like Jesus took our debt upon himself on the cross of Calvary. And finally, just as Onesimus was no longer a slave, but a brother to Philemon, so we are heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. We are all just slaves that have been forgiven and shown mercy by our Master who is in heaven." Now, we don't know. The Bible doesn't tell us what happened to Onesimus. He is mentioned in one other letter from Paul, but it's a letter to the Colossians telling them that he's on his way back. It's a separate letter to the church. And so it's a reference of the same time period. And we don't hear anything more about Onesimus after this. So we don't know what happened to him. But in history, there is information about a man who was named Onesimus, who later became the bishop of Ephesus. Now, we don't know if it was the same Onesimus, and Onesimus was a fairly common name at that time. But wouldn't it be just like our extraordinary God to take this man, this slave Onesimus, not a believer, and fleeing his master, his owner, running away with his money, a thief, and make him, through the grace of Jesus Christ, into the bishop of Ephesus? We do know that God led Onesimus to Paul in Rome, and that through the apostle, God broke Onesimus' chains of slavery and his chains of sin. And certainly God has a plan for this man, perhaps a plan that included being the bishop of Ephesus or some other important leader in the church. Our extraordinary God also has important plans for each one of us. So let's open our hearts to him. Let's be open and willing to do the things that he wants us to do for our future service to him. But also, let's be open and willing to give forgiveness to those who have erred, who have run away, who have done sins to us. Because God is so forgiving to us for the sins that we have done to him. Let us pray. Lord, we are grateful for the little we know about Onesimus, but it's enough to know how gracious and loving and forgiving you are. And we are so thankful for your mercy and for the teachings of your word. And we pray that you will help us to be open to your work in us and your plans for us as time goes by. We praise you, O Lord, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final song this morning is 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul,
worship his holy name.
Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul,
we have church chat immediately after church during fellowship, so we'll see you all there. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And now may you go in peace, carrying the love of Jesus in your heart and sharing it with all whom you meet. We pray this in his holy name. Amen.